So let's have a look at for loops. Now, these loops are phenomenal and they almost read like English sentences, quite easy to follow along. So they are constructed like this. Let's have a look. We have for and end. You've got to tell this little loop where to end things, and it's going to run around and around. This is our little raft running around and around in the river. We create inside of this for loop a computer variable, and this time I've called it I. I can call it whatever I like within reason. I can't use Julia keywords and can't use plus or minus signs in between, etc. But I've called it just I. For I in 1 to 5, now this 1 to 5, note there's no brackets around it, there's no square brackets, parentheses around it. So that makes this, and we'll look, have a look, closer look at this later, it's just a range object. It's just going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Print line we've seen before, it's just going to print a single line of text, and what it's going to print is inside of these parentheses, and at the moment it is the value that's inside of the computer variable called I. And then end. So we're going to run through this, through this, through this. What this for loop does is it just evaluates whatever's there, 1 to 5. So when it gets to 5, that's when we actually get to the end of the code. So the first time it runs through, its I is going to be 1, it's going to print 1. It goes run through it again, and because this is just a range object, it's going to go to 2, all automatically. You don't have to do anything, but the integer value, it jumps by an integer value. Let's run the code, and you see, as you expect, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to the screen. This little tab that you see there, Julia does that automatically for you, or at least the notebook here does. If you write the for line and you hit enter, it does this little places this little tab to keep things nice for you, no issue. Now have a look at this. Now this 1 to 5 didn't have any brackets around it, but now I'm putting these square brackets around what happens here. And it's these strings, these and are and words separated by a comma. So these are three separate things and they just happen to be strings inside of this these square brackets. And I'm saying for word in this print word, that's not print line, just print, comma, and this backslash t, that means that a tab, it's just going to leave a bit of space in between. I'm going to execute this line of code so you just can, you can just see what happens. So there's this computer variable called word. Each time that it runs through, it's going to take the one, then the next one, then the next one. As you can see, it's these tab, r, tab, words. Can't see the last tab there. Now we do this in teaching computer language by using these words that make sense. I just want to show you, it doesn't really matter what you call this. I'm going to call it WRT. Don't know why, just did. WRT. Doesn't matter, it's not the word word, doesn't mean anything. It's just a computer variable that I came up with, because if I ran this code again, exact same output. So it doesn't matter what it is. And this for loop is clever enough to see that these, this is a list of things actually called an array, and we'll look at these kind of things in the upcoming lecture. And it's these three, and every time it's going to take one, then the next one, then the next one. The print is this, and I didn't say a print line here because I wanted everything on the same line. If you just give it one string and there's no brackets around it, it's actually going to be clever enough to take each letter on its own. And again, I needn't have written letter there. I could have written any computer variable name there within with it, that are within the rules. So it's J with a tab, U with a tab, L with a tab, and it just iterates through each of those characters. Now have a look at this. Now I'm iterating through something that's in within curly braces. So let's see what happens there. And I'm calling my variable stuff, just to show you that I can use any word there within the rules. So for stuff in this stuff that's inside this curly braces, a 10, a 20, the word 30, and the square root of 1600. Print line, and I want it to print stuff. So whatever's in that computer variable stuff through that loop. Then a tab, and then the type of stuff. That should be interesting. So we can see what 10, 20, 30, and square root of 1600 are, and that's quite nice. So this print line, so each is going to go on a separate line. 10 is a 64-bit integer, 20 is a 64-bit integer, 30 is a string, and 40.0 is a 64-bit float. Now, I want to show you something. We created these computer variables. First, I called it word. Let's change it back to word. It just looks better. It's good to write code so that the code makes sense, but I just wanted to show you it's not the actual word itself. So I've created this variable called word, you have created a variable called letter, you have created a variable called stuff, but it's inside of a for loop. Now this is called the scope of a variable. Where does it exist? I just want to show you that if you create a variable inside of a loop like this, it does not, it ceases to exist outside of the loop unless something, I'll tell you what that something is. So here I want to show you that it doesn't exist because I'm going to say stuff and it's going to return an error. Now I don't just say stuff here and hit shift enter or shift return because I know it's going to cause an error. And sometimes you might know that something's going to cause an error, but you don't want your code to stop executing because that's what happens when there's an error. It just stops it executing. And you don't want that. In those cases, put it inside of this try catch end statement. So try and then try something, stuff, if I just write the variable, it's going to output what that variable is, but it doesn't exist. Its scope, it only exists inside of this for loop. If that returns an error, I catch that error and I put the error inside of a variable, and here I've called the variable x, and I want to print two things. I want to print a line where I tell what is the type of x, the error, and then there's this keyword show error in standard output, and then the error itself and end. So this is a try catch block of code that I am running. And just to show you, so print line, the type of the error, it's an undefined variable error because that variable does not exist. It only existed inside the loop. Once that loop was finished, it was wiped from memory. And this, the show error, standard output, the error is stuff not defined. So it's just a standard way. If ever you have code that you're worried that's not going to execute, place it here. Remember this little block of code. You can, this is pretty standard stuff. You can always have that in your code and put whatever you think might not work in there. And then the rest of your code can go outside of this. Now let's create stuff and put a string in it. I exist. If I just put stuff, it says I exist. There, I just put stuff and it threw up an error. But I put it inside of this little try catch statement. So it's still, if this happened, the code wouldn't stop executing. It would carry on. Now it exists. Now that it exists, I'm using it inside of the same for end loop there. Let's do the same thing. So it went 10, 20, 30, 40 with the types of, just as we had before. But what is stuff now? Does it still not exist? Does it cease to exist because it was in this? No, it actually doesn't. Because it existed before, it has a scope that lives outside of, its scope is I exist outside of this for loop. It is an explicit variable. It was explicitly created before this for loop. And now if inside of a for loop, its value changes as it does, first it was I exist, then it was 10, then it was 20, then it was 30, then it was the square root of 1600. It will keep the last value that it had as it should. So that is just the scope of a variable inside of a for loop. Just to show you one more thing about for loops, you can nest for loops inside of for loops. So I'm running an outside for loop where A just iterates from this range object from 1 to 3. Inside of that is another for loop that goes from 1 to 2. And then I want it to print line A and B. What do you think is going to happen? It's going to say A equals 1, there's my 1, B equals 1, and then prints it to the screen, 1 and 1, but it stays within this inner little loop, so now it's going to go 1, 2, before it exits that little loop and goes to the larger outside loops, now moves over to 2, 1, 2, 2, and then 3, 1, 3, 2. So you can nest many for loops inside of other for loops. So we've learned quite a bit here. We've learned about iterating through a for loop, and iterating through different things, through a range object, through these lists of arrays of text, through the letters of a single word, through this funny stuff that's all mixed up and jumbled of any type. And we've printed to the screen the type thereof. We've shown you that the scope of this variable inside of a loop is just internal to that. It ceases to exist outside. I showed you how to catch an error so that your program doesn't stop running, and a pretty standard output as to what to do to print it to the screen. And then to show you, if once it exists outside of this, its scope is outside of just this little loop, it actually retains that value. And then lastly, how to nest little for loops inside of bigger loops.